something by hand using the locally available material is nothing new for any particular tribal group, not only in India, anywhere in the world. People always produce something creatively from the locally available material, but yet there are certain tribes which specialize only in producing handicrafts. There are many tribes even in India. In fact, some of the tribes in northeastern parts of India and sub-Himalayan region in India, partly central belt, and some of them even down south as far as Kerala, are also known for their artistic products, which are produced by the locally available material. Often enough, a full family is involved in producing a product. In fact, it has become a kind of a cottage industry for several tribes. It's not uncommon to see the men in the families bringing about the basic structure of the product and the women and children specializing in decorating them with the colors made of the locally available vegetable dyes. Some of them are so beautiful, whatever is the material that they use. For instance, clay modeling, which is very famous with some of the central Indian tribes, and beads of Rajasthan are very famous for bead necklaces made out of lacquer and beads. In fact, an anthropologist has made a comment that ornamentation with the bead variety is so extensive, especially among the women. This anthropologist has made a comment that if a woman, a young woman, can be bedecked in the entire range of bead necklaces and other ornaments available, she may not even need a dress underneath all the decorations. So extensive are the artisan varieties that are produced by the tribal people. The menfolk do that, it has become a cottage industry. In fact, it is not very peculiar for a particular tribe, but what is very interesting is the kind of attractive products they produce from even as simple a locally available material as grass, varieties of grass that are available in the forest. Particularly these forest dwelling particular tribal groups produce it with this grass available, and bamboo is available plenty in forest, and one could see a simple bamboo flute made even by a little teenager belonging to the forest group. Basket making from the bamboo and matting is something very unique for some of these tribes living in the forest areas. Spinning is something very interesting. In fact, in North Indian tribal families like the Manipuri tribes, there is not a single girl in the family who does not produce a beautiful piece of hand-woven cloth material. Pastoral people, watch out the word pastor. Some of you who come from the Christian background or who are aware of the Christian term, pastor, used for the father in the church. Pastor means the one who tends, the one who takes care. So pastoralism as a way of life, tending cattle, sheep, goat, something very common for many tribals. So pastoralism becomes a way of life. Anthropologists have of course tried to refer to them in general as cattle herder type. Agriculture as a way of life brought in the settled life, as we said earlier in this particular unit.
Thank you.
techniques of plowing something very different depending on the particular tribe. Naturally, techniques of plowing depends on the manner in which they are cultivating and the area, topography of the area that decides what kind of plow they have got to use, what kind of techniques they have to use for plowing. Saplings, providing saplings, preparing the saplings and transplanting them is another technically very strong area, skillful area in agricultural way of life. Most important is weeding. Throughout in the tribal world as well as in rural India, we find that more and more women are employed. They are used at different stages of the cultivation round of activities in the particular tribal group or rural group. Weeding is one of the very important ones in the agricultural operations. After all, what is a weed? Weed is what that eats away the nutrients from the soil which could otherwise go to the saplings or the crop that is being brought up. So therefore, removing the weeds is a very important stage of agriculture. Harvesting again is a woman's job by and by, both in rural families and tribal families. And storage often enough is totally a woman's domain. In fact, even in rural areas in India, storing after selecting the richest part of the grains for the next crop and taking care of them, storing them carefully is part of the woman's life in agricultural families. Cattle herding is something very, very vital for some of these pastoral groups. Therefore, dairying becomes a very important activity. In fact, some of these tribals like the Todas, for instance, in Tamil Nadu, Nilgiri Hills, dairying is their way of life. So much so, buffalo becomes a very important animal for them, for their livelihood, for their economy. The another dimension which relates to cattle herding is sheep rearing and goat rearing. In fact, the artisan's way of life becomes tied down with the kind of animals that they are herding. For instance, those who are involved in cattle herding may also get involved in producing certain products with the skin of the dead cows and the dead bulls. Similarly, sheep rearing and goat rearing leads to the tribal people developing certain arts related to the sheepskin, that is wool and wool products, and the goat skin. Therefore, all these things contribute to certain artistic ways of life that the group creates for itself imaginatively using their imaginative power and creative thinking about producing certain artistic products which can be sold in their weekly tribal markets to make some money. But making money has been a much more recent phenomenon in the life of the people. Otherwise, all these products would be made for their own use, because after all, by and large, an average tribe lives a subsistence economy, does not look for too many needs outside of what they can produce themselves. Often enough, sheep and goat rearing is also accompanied by bringing up some poultry birds. They can be hens, fowls, turkeys, etc. All this coming under the broader category of animal husbandry is like the sister way of life for agriculture. In fact, one cannot come across any particular group, community, whether it is tribal or rural, leading an agricultural way of life without having some kind of animal husbandry or the other. All this will lead, particularly in a settled way of life, to division of labor. In fact, there are shepherds who go on tending goats, cows, sheep, etc. They may not own them. In fact, doing it as a service for a little bit of remuneration for service becomes a way of life for some people who cannot afford to own these animals. So, herding together the animals belonging to several families becomes a way of life for some people who do not own either land or animals themselves. So, division of labor also makes way for this. Even within the house, the division of labor is so strict that the men take care of herding the animals, taking them for grazing, whereas the women do the upkeep back at home in maintaining these animals in a healthy manner, maintaining an area in a healthy manner, including sometimes milking of the cows, etc. Especially among pastoral groups like the Todas of Nilgiris, who are taking to dairying as their basic way of life, basic economy, much more than the cow, buffalo becomes a very important animal for the Todas. Buffalo is considered even sacred. We should not forget, in Hindu mythology, buffalo has an important position, but of course, no one needs to be reminded that it is related to death of a human being, because buffalo is the vehicle of Yama, the god related to death. But however, among the Todas, buffalo remains such a sacred animal, they consider dairy as their temple where buffalo is worshipped. Apart from all this, there are folk artists who specialize in certain folk forms, whether it is singing, dancing, playing the instruments, etc. Along with singing, some have certain common traits. In fact, certain tribal groups become specialists in certain types of dancing. In fact, elderly people take a lot of interest in making their youngsters learn the proper way of dancing. This author was a witness to an Oravan group of tribals in near a port, Bhuvaneshwar, where whole lot of Oravan elders were sitting in a circle outside, of course, having their mahua beer. Mahua beer is very famous for the Oravans. Mahua is a kind of a tree which gives flowers, and out of the flower, they make a kind of a beer. So with all of them, men and women, elderly people, sitting in a circle all around, playing their drums, and all their youngsters, boys and girls, in the middle of the circle dancing. This author was a witness to a couple of young fellows taking the wrong steps in dancing, and one of the elderly man went inside the circle with the stick that he was playing the drum on, beat on the legs of some of these boys and showed the proper steps for the particular dance that was being enacted. Such is the interest of certain tribal groups in their own folk music and folk dance and drum beating, etc. Besides all this, there are certain tribes who specialize in certain very interesting areas which can dramatize the situation and call for a lot of people come and witness. Like, for instance, acrobatics. Dhammam group from Andhra Pradesh are known for this. We could have seen in some of the cities, little boys and girls with children around doing this acrobatics in places like bus stand, marketplace, having a small area and showing their prowess. Similarly, snake charming is a very, very interesting kind of a sport that certain tribal people specialize in. In fact, you and I may be afraid even at the sight of the snake, and it is a treat to watch how even a teenager tried to catch a snake, pulling it by the tail and putting it in a sack. Even a dangerous, poisonous, venomous snake like a cobra. We have all seen in the cities monkey tricks. These people, many of them are tribals from certain areas where monkeys are abundantly available, like certain parts of Madhya Pradesh. They will catch these monkeys, training these monkeys to play the role of Rama, Sita, getting together, marrying, etc. These are monkeys trained by these tribal people. Of course, most monkey tricks definitely draw the inspiration from the themes of our epics, and therefore, some of these people who play monkey tricks are already converted away from the tribal way of life and learned quite a bit of the non-tribal kind of life. Apart from this, there are certain tribes which started off as nomadic. That means they never stick on to a particular place. They keep on moving from place to place. Many of them are leading a very colorful life, like the Lambanis, for instance, who are well known throughout Karnataka, northern parts particularly, and the southern parts of Maharashtra. These people, especially women, who specialize in producing certain handicrafts, they are beautifully, colorfully dressed with lot of ornaments bedecked on their bodies, but they do not live in a particular place. In fact, they stay in a place for a couple of weeks, selling their interesting products to the people in the neighborhood, whoever is attracted by them, but nomadism has become a way of life. In fact, it may be interesting for us to note that they may continue to be the nomadic people, not necessarily because they have chosen it, but mainly because wherever they go, they stay only for a short time, and if something happens in the neighborhood, like something getting lost or some other negative thing happening, often enough, these are the people who are suspected by the people in the neighborhood. In a way, it has pushed them not to have alternate ways of life. Perhaps this is also an additional reason, not only their choice, they are in a way forced to continue to lead the nomadic way of life. Lambanis and gypsies are the ready examples of the nomadic way of life of tribal people. Apart from all this, there are certain tribes who are known as criminal tribes. In an earlier unit, you would have learnt that criminal tribes had been named like that during pre-independent times by the British themselves. But unfortunately, most criminal tribes named by the British were those who got involved in freedom movement. They rebelled, so they were identified as criminal. But it's not that all tribals were like that, but there are some tribes who lived on committing crimes, but crime no tribal would commit by himself or herself. In fact, tribal people, by their own choice, do not commit crimes. In fact, they are basically very naive, simple, and honest, and they do not choose to commit crimes. As a matter of fact, it is the non-tribal people in the neighborhood who, in order to achieve certain goals that they want to achieve for a short time or a long time, use these tribal people who are very gullible as puppets and make them commit certain crimes, including murder. But these people, tribals, get into the trap and do it for petty cashes, now and then what they receive from these non-tribal people. Let us recapitulate what we have learnt in this part of the lecture. We have tried to understand how artisan is, on the one hand, a common feature of tribal life, in the sense every tribe produces something or the other through handmade using the material locally available. But that apart, there are certain tribes who specialize in certain handicrafts. We have also learnt how people live with the animal tending, like the cattle herding, sheep and goat rearing. And we have also tried to understand how certain tribes live a nomadic way of life. That means not settling down in any particular place. They keep on moving from place to place. Every place they stay only for a short time and then keep on moving to another place. But apart from all this, we have also tried to identify how criminal as a way of life is not always a choice of the people among the tribes who are otherwise very honest, naive and upright, but how they are using as puppets by the non-tribal people in order to achieve their own short and long-term goals.